okay.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Coastal Lake Community Church. Two announcements I have. First of all, I want to wish Debbie a happy 60th birthday today. She couldn't make it in this morning, but we're still celebrating. And also, their lead is fastened this on to me. She has some signs that we can post on the different places that we know people will see it. Some of them are laminated and some of them are not. If you have a space where they are dry, then please pick one up from her and get the word out.
I first heard about this place in the sign on the porch. Oh,
yeah?
I even heard that.
Well, that's how it works. Yeah, perfect. All right, let's start with our opening prayer and join me as we pray. Almighty God, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our heart by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand and let's sing, The King is Coming.
He's coming.
Surprise you what the Lord has done. Come First of all fruit of the ground which you harvest from your land that the Lord your God is giving you, you shall put it in a basket, and you shall go to the place that the Lord your God will choose to make his name and to dwell there. And you shall go to the priest who is in office at that time and say to him, I declare today to the Lord and your God that I have come unto the land that the Lord swore to our fathers to give us. Then the priest shall take the basket from your hand and set it down before the altar of the Lord your God. And you shall make response before the Lord your God. The one named Aramaim was my father, and he went down into Egypt and sojourned there. Few in number, and there he became a nation, great, mighty, and populous. And the Egyptians treated us harshly and humiliated us and laid on us hard labor. Then we cried to the Lord, the God of our fathers, and the Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction, our toil, and our oppression. And the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with great deeds of terror, with signs and wonders. And he brought us into the place, into this place, and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. And behold, now I bring the first of the fruit of the ground, which you, O Lord, have given me. And you shall set it down before the Lord your God, and worship before the Lord your God. And you shall rejoice in all the good that the Lord your God has given you and to your house, you and the Levite and the sojourner who is among you. Then you shall say before the Lord your God, I have removed the sacred portion out of my house, and moreover, I have given it to the Levite, to the sojourner, the fatherless, the widow, according to all your commandments that you have commanded me. And the Lord has declared today that you are the people for his treasured possession, as he has promised you, and that you are to keep all of his commandments, and that he will set you in praise and in fame and in honor high above all nations that he has made, and that you shall be a person holy to the Lord your God, as he promised.
Please join us in singing the hymn, Bread of the World, In Mercy Grow.
Our third reading is in Hebrews 13. Let brotherly love continue. Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. And do not be led away by diverse and strange teachings, for it is good for the heart to be strengthened by grace, not by foods which have not benefited those who devoted to them. We have an altar from which those who serve the Jewish tabernacle have no right to eat. For the bodies of those animals whose blood is brought into the holy places by the high priest as a sacrifice for sin are burned outside the camp. So Jesus also suffered outside the gate in order to sanctify the people through his own blood. Therefore, let us go to him outside the camp and bear the reproach he endured. For here we have no lasting city, but we seek the city that is to come. Through him, therefore, let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God, that is, the fruit of lips that acknowledge his name. And do not neglect to do good and to share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God. The word of the Lord. May we stand for these thanksgivings and petitions. It's like the prayer of the people. Together we read the dark passages of Leviticus. We pray, Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you most humble and hearty thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all people. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life. But above all, for your amazing love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray you, give us that due sense of all your mercies, that our hearts may be always thankful, and that we show forth your praise not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Our Father, because we believe it is your will, we pray for this community, for this nation, and for the nations of the world, for all who work for freedom, justice, and peace among the nations, for the just and proper use of your creation, for the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and war, for those who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble whom we make known. For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy, for the peace and unity of your church, for Pastor Al and Sue,
for the clergy
of this community, and for all who minister the gospel, for all who serve you in this congregation,
for all who seek the truth,
and for ourselves that we may be there. Together we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May you see.
don't think there's any more announcements. We'll do the offering now.
Oh,
Rob, could you?
In terms of announcements, can you tell us what we can expect in Sunday?
I think we'll start for this pattern from here on again till Alan Super arrives.
So we'll continue with this Sunday by Sunday.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above in heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
We've had some interesting Bible studies the last couple of months, but it's good to be back. Some years ago, back in Hamilton, Ontario, I attended an annual World Day of Prayer service that, just like our church here in Mille Lacs, was multi-denominational. It included Anglicans, Baptists, Pentecostals, United Church, and the Roman Catholics who hosted it, all with a common faith in Jesus, no matter how we understood that faith or how we worshiped. As the service progressed, the preacher of the day As the service progressed, the preacher of the day read several passages from the Old and New Testaments. And he said something that I haven't forgot about those readings. He said, "These are our stories." Now, he was a bit of a liberal, so I read something into that. But it was a good line. These are our stories. They're mostly Jewish stories, of course, but they're not just Jewish stories, they're our stories. They're our stories because they were Jesus' stories. They're the stories that shaped Jesus' understanding of who he was and why he came. Like the stories of all the great religions, they provide a narrative framework, a storyline, for the society and the culture that they belong to. A great problem in our Western countries these days is that Western society has largely given up the biblical storyline that used to inform its values. 2020 Gallup poll indicated that only 47% of Americans have any active involvement in a church, synagogue, mosque, or temple. In Canada, the figure is considerably lower. Now, certainly, we Christians have sometimes misread those biblical stories, and we've applied them in some pretty horrible ways, slavery being one obvious example. But because Western society has largely abandoned that Jewish-Christian narrative, we are now a fragmented culture without any unifying spiritual narrative. That means that our values, our laws, and our collective goals are up for grabs, and they'll reflect whatever ideology happens to be the flavor of the day. It also means that when we speak the gospel, we can no longer assume that our audience understands a lot of the religious words and ideas that their grandparents grew up with and that you and I still take for granted. So there's a sense in which the 21st century is a bit like the first century. There's a sense in which we're starting all over again from scratch. But even if the culture has abandoned these stories, there's a way in which they are still our stories, and always will be. Much of what you read in the Old Testament is history, but the Bible has a particular understanding of history. It's an understanding that history, the history of Israel, is about God's dealings with God's people. And that means that we can find in it illustrations that apply to us as God's people, to us collectively as the church, and to us as individuals. So I'd like to see how that idea plays out in today's readings. Our first reading is the institution of the Passover. When the Jews were getting ready to leave Egypt, every family had to offer a lamb as a sacrifice. They had to mark their houses with the blood, and they had to consume the meal that same evening. This was no genteel dinner party with socializing well into the evening. These guys, as we used to say in the army, were getting ready to bug out. The text says, "This is how you shall eat it. With your belt fastened, your sandals on your feet, and your walking stick in your hand, and you shall eat it quickly." They were dressed for the road. And that first Passover meal was going to be their sustenance to begin a 40-year journey through the Arabian desert. That desert journey involved more than just rocks and sand and the occasional oasis. It was also a journey in a spiritual desert. And you and I are on the same journey through that same desert. Except that for most of us, the trip may last 80 years or more instead of their 40. Which is a mercy, because just as for Moses' crowd, so also for us, it's a journey of getting to know God and getting to know ourselves and getting to know how to be in a right relation to God and with each other. Which explains why the first revelation on that journey was the Ten Commandments. In our second reading, we have the instructions for the Feast of First Fruits, which was a harvest celebration, something like our Thanksgiving Day. Actually, they had two of these feasts, one at the spring harvest, the other at the autumn harvest. And of course, they had to wait until they reached the promised land, planted crops, and reaped the harvest before they could observe these feasts. Today's second reading refers to the spring harvest. The striking thing about this feast is the declaration that they made when they brought their offering. My father, that's Abraham, and Isaac and Jacob, was a wandering Aramean, came from the vicinity of Aram. which is not in Israel. He went down into Egypt, few in number, and became a great nation. And the Egyptians treated us harshly, and we cried to the Lord, and the Lord brought us out with a mighty hand, and he brought us into this land, a land flowing with milk and honey, a wandering Aramean. They're remembering that Abraham, their ancestor, was a pagan, a convert, and a man on a journey, just as his children and all their offspring were and still are also on a journey. And they remember that the purpose of that journey was to create not just a bunch of converted individuals, but a nation. A people whom God, at the end of that passage, calls his segula, his treasured possession. The Hebrew word means something like the most valuable thing in a king's treasury. That's how God views his people. That's how God views you and me. Being that treasure is the purpose of our journey. Another striking thing about the Feast of First Fruits is that it was celebrated on the Sunday immediately after the Passover. Sunday immediately after the Passover, that's the day of resurrection. So Paul in 1 Corinthians 7 says, Christ our Passover has been sacrificed for us. And in 1 Corinthians 15 he says, but now Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who are asleep. He goes on to say that in Christ all will be made alive, Christ the first fruits, and after that those who are Christ's at his coming. So you and I are not only God's special treasure, we're his harvest at the end of the journey. And Jesus' resurrection is the prototype of what that harvest is going to look like. Jesus said that the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which when a man found it, he sold all that he had in order to buy that field. Who would have guessed that from God's perspective, the treasure harvested from that field would turn out to be us? And who would have guessed that, like so much else in the Old Testament, the promised land would turn out to be a metaphor for something better? For even though the Jewish state was reestablished in 1948, never since the time when Joshua entered the land has it achieved the ideal of peace and holiness that Moses wrote about. That was not possible. And neither is it possible for any other state, including Pierre Trudeau's notion of the just society. Jesus gave us the short version of why it's not possible when he said, my kingdom is not of this world. And that takes us to our third reading, where the writer to the Hebrews says, here we have no lasting city. Or as the King James Version has it, here we have no abiding city. That writer would soon come to know about, and maybe even witness, the prime example of here we have no abiding city. For in AD 70, Trajan's army destroyed the city of Jerusalem, demolished its temple, and carried off its treasures to Rome. If even the holy city, the place where God symbolically dwelt, could fall to a pagan army, how can any place be permanent? The brute fact is, here we have no abiding city. But the writer adds, we seek the city that is to come. When you and I on our journeys came to Malacky, some of us thought we found the next best thing to paradise. Of course, that's what they think in Agahique, where I spent 2 weeks last week. But my brothers and sisters, spiritually speaking, we're still on the journey. We're still passing through that place that my Jewish friends, when they're feeling cynical about our culture, call Mizraim. Mizraim is the Hebrew name for Egypt. We're still passing through that place that the English poet T.S. Eliot called the wasteland. We're still on the journey, and we're on it together. To give us a spiritual focus for our journey, Jesus gave us a new feast. The writer to the Hebrews says, we have an altar from which those who serve the Jewish tabernacle have no right to eat. That's because they didn't believe in Jesus. The altar he refers to was a hill outside Jerusalem, where at the same time as the Passover lambs were being killed, Jesus made that one perfect and sufficient sacrifice, satisfaction, and oblation for the sins of the whole world. So what we offer here at the Lord's table is a very different kind of sacrifice. You could argue that it's not really a sacrifice at all, because what Jesus did was perfect, sufficient, and unrepeatable. But we use that word sacrifice metaphorically because it's something that we offer to God. The writer to the Hebrews says, through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer up to God a sacrifice of praise. That is, the fruit of lips that acknowledge his name. Then he adds the other half. Don't neglect to do good and to share what you have. You see there, love God, love your neighbor. And he concludes, such sacrifices are pleasing to God. So here's the takeaway, and I think it's a takeaway I'm going to be talking more about over the next several weeks. How do we walk this journey together to the city that is to come? We walk it knowing that Jesus walked it before, and that the Holy Spirit goes with us. We walk it knowing that everyone has baggage, and some of our baggage is known only to God. Let's walk it gently, as companions who are walking each other home.
Preparation for the communion. Please join us in singing the next song, which is Hear, O My Lord.
Thank you.
join me in the liturgy that you have every this evening. You who truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are at peace with your neighbors and intend to lead the new life, following the commandments of God and walking in his ways, draw near with faith and take this sacrament to your comfort. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your many and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are that Lord who always delights in showing mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, as we eat and drink in faith, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body of our Lord Jesus Christ, that our souls may be washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Blessing and glory and thanksgiving be yours, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, because in your tender mercy you gave Jesus, your only Son, to take our nature upon him and to suffer death on the cross for our redemption. He made there once for all time a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world. And in his holy gospel, he commanded us to continue this perpetual memorial of his precious death until his coming again. On the night when he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you do this, drink it in remembrance of me." My brothers and sisters, Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us. Therefore, you will receive the elements, take you back to the seat, and we'll commune together. Body of our Lord Jesus, preserve your bodies and souls to everlasting life. Make this in remembrance of Christ's blood, which shed for you in this age. We pray together after communion. Almighty and ever-living God, we heartily thank you for feeding us in this sacred memorial with the spiritual food sacrament of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us thereby of your favor and goodness towards us, and that we are truly members of his mystical body, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of your everlasting kingdom. And here we offer and present to you, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice to you. And although we are unworthy, yet we beseech you to accept this our abundant duty and service, not grieving our merits, but pardon our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, the world without end.
Join us in singing the last two stanzas of this hymn.
Upon us and give us peace now and forevermore.